welcome or welcome back to this channel. My name is Sarah. Today I would like to show you my favorite fall and winter handmade coats because I figured now that the weather is getting a little bit cooler, maybe you'd like to sink your teeth into a longer, maybe more arduous, but more rewarding project such as a coat. I know that when it starts to get cooler for me, I do start thinking about what can I make that will last me this season that I will be able to put on and wear quite often that'll keep me warm, because there aren't a whole lot of things we can sew that keep us very, very warm. There's only so much wool jersey out there. A coat is definitely a timeless piece that you can wear throughout many seasons, many years, that will last you, that you can wear every day, and that really, when you put time and effort into it, it can really pay off. However, they are also typically quite difficult because there are a lot of tailoring techniques involved. It's quite heavy, it's difficult to fit the big pieces under your machine, and I know that I have the patience for about one big coat project every 2 years, and for now, my last one was about 6 months ago, I think I finished it, and so I'm still, my motivation is still filling up. So I have five projects to show you today, five different coats that I've made, four that I wear all the time that have become staples in my closet and that have lasted me up to five seasons so far, and one dud that I want to show you so I can explain why it's a dud and to warn you of perhaps future complications with your coat projects so you avoid making the same mistakes as me. The first coat that I would like to show you is a trench coat that I wear in the spring and the fall all the time during transitional seasons, usually when the weather is between 50 and 65 degrees, which is a lot of the time. And it's something I absolutely love, and it is this Isla trench coat, and the pattern is by Named Patterns. I love this coat. I made it back in 2018. I think this was one of my first serious coats that was a real success for me and that I was very proud of. It was also very difficult to make. All the little fiddly pieces, like you can see these sleeve tabs, were difficult to fit into the machine. I broke a lot of needles making this one. But I love this one. I love this fabric. I found this fabric, I can't exactly remember the composition. I think it's a cotton twill, but it's backed. It's got like a double layer to it, and it is water resistant, and I found this at Sacré Coupon in the north of Paris by the Sacré-Cœur, which I mentioned in my last video as one of my favorite fabric shops, and I highly recommend it if you ever come visit Paris or if you live in France. And I got these resin buttons that are wood colored from the Mercerie de Charonne, which is also my favorite haberdashery in Paris. The sleeves are lined in a regular lining fabric so that they slip over the shoulders and arms easily and they don't tug. And then the back and the facing I lined with this beige Czech Burberry inspired polyester fabric that I found at Minerva, which is an online fabric shop based in the UK. I really love these colors. I think the color of the outer shell fabric is the perfect beige for me. I think it's a cooler beige and not too orange or yellow, and it works really well with my wardrobe whether I'm wearing warmer or cooler colors. I think that the lining fabric is a little bit too warm for me. I think that if I were to make this again, I would make it with a different lining fabric, but I did want to attempt to make something that was slightly Burberry inspired because I could, and I'm really happy with the result. I love the classic shape of this trench coat. It has all of the details of a trench coat, including its straight cut, the collar belt, welt pockets, and sleeve tabs. It's double breasted as well, and I really like the waist tie because I do like cinching in my waist when I can. This has become a wardrobe staple for me. I wear it all the time. It has gotten more than 10 seasons of wear if you count this fall season, and it's starting to show a little bit of wear. For example, the lining in the sleeve has ripped in a few places, and I need to figure out how to fix that without having to replace the whole thing. And the cuffs are starting to look a little worn at the edges, and especially the edge of the pocket welts. But I love this coat, and I hope that it will last me many more seasons to come. It was a very difficult coat to make, but also one of my proudest makes, and I love it. I shortened this coat about 30 centimeters because I wanted a coat that was just below the knee length rather than mid-calf length, which is the original length of the pattern. And I thought that I had done it in a logical fashion, but in the end, I was missing about 20, 30 centimeters. Well, exactly. I think I forgot the interfacing piece. I'll show you. You can see it here. It was missing this much. There was a gap here. And so what I ended up doing is just cutting out a little bit of extra fabric and sewing it to the two sides here and just patching this on the inside. Luckily it's on the inside and not on the outside, but this just reminds me that I need to improve my pattern modification skills. I still make mistakes like this today. I love this detail now. It reminds me that I made this coat, that it's mine, and that I put a lot of effort into it, and that it's unique. And I'm glad that it turned out okay without that being a very complicated error to fix. This coat is also really easy to dress up or dress down. I've worn it with more fancy dresses. I wear it with jeans. I wear it with just regular sweater dresses like this one. It works with almost all of my wardrobe, and I just love it. The next coat that I would like to show you is the silver cocoon coat that I showed you in my last video, which I will link here. I absolutely love this coat. It's a little bit more difficult to wear just because with this houndstooth pattern, it's a very busy sort of patterned fabric, and so it's harder to match with my wardrobe, but I like wearing it when I can. It is more of a light sort of shell coat. You can see it's not super reinforced. It doesn't keep me super warm, but it's great for transitional weather, and I especially like to wear it in the fall because it works with fall colors pretty well. I love the notch collar detail and the welt pockets as well. It's got great pockets that are lined with just this regular lining fabric. On the inside, it's lined as well. This was a relatively simple project and a simpler coat to start with. I think it was one of my first coat projects, and I really like it. It's a little bit more difficult to wear because I mentioned it doesn't go with all of my wardrobe, and also the drop shoulders make it difficult to balance a bag, but I like the shape, the slight cocoon shape and oversized shape. It's easy to fit a chunky sweater underneath, and I like the just below the knee length as well. I think it's a very flattering length for coats. There's no front fastening, but it is slightly oversized, so you can sort of overlap the front edges together to keep yourself warm. And because it can fit such chunky clothes underneath, you can still bundle up underneath and keep yourself relatively warm. This is a neoprene-backed viscose twill fabric that I bought also at Sacré Coupon. I was really excited to find this one because it has a really great hold, and that's because of the neoprene, the polyester neoprene backing it. It's a very bouncy sort of hold, and yeah, I think it's very interesting for this sort of coat, and I was very, very happy to find it. I swear, every time I go there, I find something absolutely unique and interesting, and I highly recommend it. The next project that I would like to share with you is actually the flop, and I will explain why. It is this sew over it Anacote from their ebook Work to Weekend, and I will show you it full length as well. This coat features a wide lapeled collar. It is mid-calf length. It has simple side seam pockets and a belt around the middle. This pattern is unlined and it is meant for lighter fabrics. I think they do mention that you can make it in wool, but since it's unlined, I would imagine that it's more meant to be in a lighter gabardine fabric or in a viscose as more of an accessory to your wardrobe rather than a coat that keeps you warm. My mistake was to make it in this burgundy sort of polyester wool imitation. I was trying to make something for the fall season to somewhat keep me warm. This fabric is so soft, it's so nice. I got this at the Coupon Saint-Pierre, which is another store that sells fabric in cuts of 3 meters at a time in Paris. And I ended up drafting my own lining, but you can see here, I kind of messed it up in that I didn't draft it big enough and I had to add a strip of fabric to cover the space between the lining fabric and the facing, which was a pain. But I made this coat originally to go with an outfit for a friend's wedding who got married in fall 2019, and it worked for that outfit for that night. And then I also wore it for my French nationality ceremony, which I got to wear with the same dress, and it just made me happy to be able to wear my own handmade clothes in a fully coordinated outfit for this event because it was very important to me and I wanted to wear something that I had made. I was really happy to have made it then, but I just don't wear it because there are so many little things that make it a badly constructed coat. I think that this is because the instructions didn't include any tailoring details that I now know to be necessary for a well-made coat, such as planning turn of cloth or shaping the collars or making sure that the seam lines fold in the right direction when you turn it out. For example, the collar, the seam shouldn't be around the middle. I'll show you here. You can kind of see the way the collar sits. You can see the seam sitting around the top of it rather than rolling underneath. And usually patterns plan for this and the collar is shaped a certain way so that the seam line rolls underneath. Or for example, you can see the points of the collar are really floppy. And I did interface on the inside of this collar and I added interfacing, but the points just kind of like flop around when I wear it and it's just not very graceful in the slightest. And you can kind of see also it sags a lot at the bottom hem, or it just doesn't sit like a well-made coat, and I don't end up wearing it because I just feel a little bit ridiculous, like I'm wearing a dressing gown that's in coat fabric around my body. And so now I realize that tailoring on the inside of coats is very necessary, and I will not make the same mistake again. The next coat that I would like to show you is a winter coat that I like to wear, especially after I can't wear my trench coat anymore and it's too cold, or in the springtime when my wardrobe is a little bit more cooler colors. And it is this Yokohama coat by Mercerie. Mercerie is a fabric shop based in France, but they also have a few patterns, and this is one of them from their Japanese-inspired collection. And so this is an oversized coat with a rounded shoulder shape, kind of a round cocoon shape in the bottom, and a wide collar and wide lapel. I used this boiled wool in this teal color from Minerva, which is a online fabric shop based in the UK. This fabric was gifted to me in exchange for an article on their website, which you can read all about. I'll link my profile below on their website. And some of this fabric is still available in their online shop. And so if you'd like to make a project with this as well, I will link it below, just so you know, it's an affiliate link because I was sponsored for this project. And then the inside lining fabric is a black and white polka dot fabric that I found at Sotissu, which is a French company that I really like purchasing from as well, and that I mentioned in my last video. This pattern is only available in French. You could use Google Translate to translate it, especially because now it exists as a PDF, so it'd be easier to copy and paste into Google Translate. But even as a French speaker, I had a hard time following the instructions, and I had to look to online tutorials to understand, for example, the welt pocket instructions. And so if you're not familiar with making coats, especially with adding your own tailoring techniques, then I would be careful with this pattern, because I also added a lot of details that were not included in the pattern. For example, I added these bound buttonholes because only regular buttonholes were included in the pattern. I thought that was kind of strange for such a thick wool coat, or the kind of thick fabrics that you would need for this coat. I also modified a little bit the collar pieces to try and get the turn of the seam to turn towards the underside of the collar after my debacle with the burgundy coat. I added more interfacing to the collar piece than was called for in the pattern. For example, I had the whole thing interfaced and then I added a second layer minus the seam allowances on the inside. I also tailored this turn of cloth here on the lapel so that it would turn a certain way and it would lay a certain way. And for warmth, I added a layer of wadding, just cotton wadding, between the shell fabric and the lining fabric to make it warmer. So be careful with this. I find that their marketing and the pictures that they have available on their website for this pattern is a little bit misleading, just because you're not going to obtain the same results as you see in the pictures, because some of the pictures look really well tailored and very almost stiff, and it hangs really well. You will not obtain those results without knowing yourself how to add these tailoring techniques. Despite that, I really love this coat. It is the perfect length. I really love this color. It's a little bit difficult to make work with my wardrobe as well, just because it's such a loud color, or loud for me, that I like it to be a feature when I wear it, and I don't want it clashing with my wardrobe or clashing with the clothes that I'm wearing underneath. So a lot of times I like to wear it with neutrals so that it really stands out, and I feel fabulous in this coat. I love this coat. It doesn't close very well in the front. The way that it's designed, it just pops open all the time, and so I don't think it's meant to be worn closed, and so that's a bit misleading information as well, that they've featured that. But I usually wear it with a really thick woolen scarf, and so it keeps me warm anyway even though it's open. I love the length just below the knee and the way it sits. I recommend making it if you have the experience to add those tailoring techniques and you are experienced with working with this kind of fabric. So I like to save the best for last, and this coat is definitely my favorite and one of my most proudest makes. So if you've stuck around to the end, you are in for a treat. This is the Bella Loves Patterns Traveler Coat. This is what I'm wearing currently, and it is my favorite coat that I've ever made. It is beautiful and really, really well designed. So bravo to Bella Loves Patterns. She is a London-based creator, and she puts so much intention into her patterns and so much small but important details to make them look professional and so that they sit well. And I'm just, this was at the same time the most involved make that I've made in a long time, but also something that I didn't have to fiddle with. For example, she includes all of the tailoring details necessary so that a coat sits the way it's supposed to, so that it's nicely structured and that it keeps you warm. And I didn't have to add anything to it. So at the same time, it was very reassuring and I was able to relax into this project and it was just a pleasure. It did take me a really long time though. I counted. And from beginning to end, tracing the pattern to finishing the final details, it took me 56 hours. To give you an idea, I started this last January and I finished it around April of this year. So it took me months of just working on this, of just fitting these giant pieces into my machine. And so this is also why my patience for coat making has dwindled and I must recover, because even though I'm very happy with this one, it's a lot of time and it's somewhat of an investment, because if you want to work with really nice fabrics and make a coat that's gonna last you for years, it does cost a little bit more. But yeah, I'm really happy with this one. So this coat features a double-breasted front, a moderate oversized silhouette, a wide notched collar, dropped shoulders, welt pockets, a back vent, and a belt situated at the natural waist. It includes instructions for interfacing, tailoring, and adding little details to make sure that it sits correctly. I made this coat in this dove gray wool cashmere blend. It's a dead stock fabric from Italy, I think, and I bought it from Core Fabrics in Canada. I went to go visit my family in November 2021, so a year ago, and I had this delivered to them. When I knew I was going, I checked out what they had, and this one, I was keeping my eye on it for a while, and it was just, ugh. It's so beautiful. It's really soft. It's starting to pill just a little bit, but it's just the most beautiful quality fabric. I lined it with this pearly white flannel black lining, which I haven't been able to find in France yet or in Europe yet. So if you know of where to get flannel backed lining, let me know. But this is something that Core Fabrics was stocking, and I think they stock it on a regular basis. I think you can find it a lot easier in North America, because for making coats, warmth is a very important factor. This keeps me incredibly warm. It's really, really well constructed. I used black buttons as well in the front here because I liked the contrast between this lighter gray and black buttons. It features super deep welt pockets, which are just an absolute pleasure to wear. I can't tell you how much I love this coat. I love wearing it. I look forward to being able to wear it. I finished it a little bit late in the season, around April, to wear it very much in the spring. And so as soon as it got cold enough to wear, I've been wearing it with pleasure this year. It's such a luxurious feel, the satin lining and then the wool on the outside. I was really happy to be able to work with these quality fabrics, and it's perfectly warm. I went out earlier to go get lunch, for example, today, and I was wearing it, and it's about 35 degrees Fahrenheit with wind chill right now today, and I didn't feel it at all. It was really warm, it was really nice, and I just feel so elegant in this coat. I highly recommend Bella Loves Patterns, and if you want to try making this coat, you can go into it. It does say that it's more of an intermediate advanced pattern, but because she has planned for all of the interfacing, all of the tailoring details, everything you need for making this coat, you can go into it and know that you will get a good quality coat without having to add anything extra to it. So those are all the coats that I wanted to share with you today, and those are definitely some of my favorite makes that I've ever made that I wear all the time. I hope that I've inspired you, if you have not tried making a coat yet, to get into coat making, because even though it requires a lot more time and sometimes tailoring techniques are a bit difficult to learn, it is definitely rewarding in the end. It's something that you will be able to wear for many seasons to come, and unlike a piece like a pair of pants or a shirt, it's something that you can wear every day during a season, and that will keep you warm, and that's really important to a wardrobe in the end. Today I am wearing another sew over at Heather dress. This one is in a cable sort of knit polyester fabric. It's an interlock or Ponte Roma fabric, and I really love this one. It's a little bit stiffer, so sometimes the neckline stands away from my body, but I think it's okay. It's another one of my favorite sweater dresses, and I like to wear it especially in the wintertime. I have linked all of the patterns that I've talked about and fabric shops and any fabric if it's available in the description below. And if you have any coats that you've made that have become staples in your wardrobe, let me know in the comments below. I'm always looking for new patterns to check out or new coat patterns, even though my patience for coat patterns is, like I said, limited to one every 2 years or so. And definitely since my last coat project was such a big one, even though it turned out really well and I'm really happy with the results, I do not have patience for another coat project for at least another year. I've been thinking of maybe getting into making a blazer, for example, because I do really love working with wool, but I have another really big project coming up that I am excited to share with you soon, so I cannot get into any blazer or coat projects right now. But yeah, in the future. I really like making them, especially in the wintertime, because you can really get into it, and it's, like I said, very rewarding at the end, and it's something that I really enjoy, and it's something that I feel the most proud of when I wear, especially out and about. Like, it's something that keeps me warm, and it's something that is really impressive, a coat. I highly encourage trying it yourself. Thank you for watching this video. I hope that you enjoyed it, and I will see you again soon. Bye-bye.